Okay, now before you go on, we got back in Acts again. If you read the Acts account, here's Stephen before he's martyred is going through all of these things, and he brings up this particular account. We'll start at 17. But when the time of the promise drew near, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt. We've already read that. Till another king arose that did not know Joseph. This man dealt treacherously with our people and oppressed our forefathers, making them expose their babies so they might not live. At this time, Moses was born and was well-pleasing to God, and he was brought up in his father's house for 3 months. But when he was set out, Pharaoh's daughter took him away and brought him up as her own son. And Moses learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was mighty in words and deeds. Well, that's not something that we just read, right?
Right.
Okay, so that's why Stephen's speech gives you all kinds of extra information you're not going to get in the Old Testament. But it says that he was brought up in the wisdom of the Egyptians and was mighty in words and deeds. Now, in the Exodus account, we're going to see at the burning bush, which is what, 3? He says that, Lord, I'm a man of faltering lips or haltering lips or whatever. So there's no contradiction. Just because somebody is mighty in words and deeds doesn't mean that he's mighty speaking, right? In other words, I actually sat in, do you remember the guy that had the, stutter that we sat in the church in Massachusetts years ago? It was so bad that when he spoke, his face would actually contort, and he'd get stuck on a letter. And everybody in the congregation would be going, they know the word, and they'd just be wanting to blurt it out. But what he said was a good message. It's just that he was faltering or haltering in lips, whatever the term is. So there's no contradiction there, so keep that in mind. All right, and then it says, when he was 40 years old, here's where we are right now. It came out into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. Just so you know, Moses' life is kind of divided up into three 40-year sections. Okay, the first is the 40 that he's at now. He goes for 40 more, and then he is the great deliverer. Three 40-year sections in his life. All right, and seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended and avenged him who was oppressed and struck down the Egyptian. For he supposed that his brethren would have understood that God would deliver them by his hand. But they did not understand. He knew that a deliverer was coming, all right? And he thought, I'm going to be able to show this. Here, God has put me in this position of being Pharaoh's, the son of Pharaoh's daughter. I must be the deliverer, okay? That's what he must be thinking when he goes to do this. And they didn't understand him, all right? So what does it say? The next day, he appeared to two of them as they were fighting and tried to reconcile them, saying, men, why, you are brethren, why do you do wrong? But he who did his neighbor wrong pushed him away, saying, who made you a ruler and a judge over us? Which is exactly what you just read. Do you want to kill me as you did the Egyptian yesterday? Then it's saying, this saying, Moses fled and became a dweller in the land of Midian, where he had two sons. So that's where we are right now, at that particular point in there. But it added in a little bit, it get clarified a little bit, and the account, the reason why, I'll just stop for 1 second to tell you that the reason why in the book of Acts, Stephen's speech terms the way it does, is these people, he's speaking to the rulers of Israel, standing there in front of the temple, you know, day by day, showing how great they are and how God loves them because they are the stewards of, you know, the temple and all of this stuff. And God loves Israel because we have the temple and land. And everything that Stephen is talking about in Acts chapter 7, he's referring to things that are happening outside of the land of Israel. He's saying that God's presence is not confined to Israel. And you people need to wake up and you need to see it. When you read this account, you're going to see how he talks about all of these things. And Stephen almost diminishes the fact that the temple is there at all. You people don't understand the very God that you are the stewards of. He is the God of everything, not just there. And so that's why he's bringing in Moses outside of Israel. Not just Jerusalem, but outside of Israel completely. And as you go through that, read it from that context, and it will help open up Acts 7. But there are other angles to look at Acts 7. Don't limit it to that. But one or two times when you read it, see how God is pointing to the greatness of himself outside of Israel. And as I said, we'll go at other approaches to that particular speech as well, because there's a lot in Acts chapter 7. But please go ahead from there.
13?
Yep.
Now when Pharaoh heard this thing, he sought to slay Moses, but Moses fled from the face of Pharaoh and dwelt in the land of Midian, and he sat down by a well. Now the priest of Midian had 7 daughters, and they came and drew water and filled the trough to water their father's flock.
Okay, what does that strike you as? He went and sat down by a well. What, do you see anything about that? Jesus at the well in John chapter 4, Rebecca at a well, Rachel at a well, all of these things again and again and again are pointing to the significance of the well. And it's a picture of the water of life, okay? All of these things are circling around wells. And it's a really great study. We won't get into it too deeply, but you'll see this happening throughout the Bible. And then finally, Jesus gives us the final picture of the person at the woman at the well. All right? So there you go. I am the water of life.
And the shepherds came and drove them away. Moses stood up and helped them and watered their flock. And when they came to Reuel, their father, he said, "How is it that you are come so soon today?" And they said, "An Egyptian delivered us out of the hand of the shepherds, and also drew water enough for us and watered the flock."
Okay, this guy Reuel is going to have a whole bunch of names in here. Jethro, Reuel, a couple other names, just so you know. It's the same guy. They have different names. Sometimes a person will have two or three names he's referred to, Jacob and Israel, etc. But just so you know, this, it's the same person. For whatever reason, they have a different name here than they do later, but it is the same guy.
Isn't it funny they thought he was an Egyptian?
Exactly. Well, you know, he was probably
dressed like
one, and absolutely. So, and I noticed that too while you were reading it, that he's an Egyptian. And he probably, because he was raised in Pharaoh's courts and raised in the wisdom of Egypt, he probably had an Egyptian accent. You know, he may have spoke Hebrew to mom perfectly, but he probably had an Egyptian accent as well. So they probably knew that.
And then, you know, they had their own haircuts.
Yeah. That's right. So that's probably just how they recognized him in this case.
And he said unto his daughters, "And where is he? Why is it that ye have left the man? Call him that he may eat bread." And Moses was content to dwell with the man, and he gave Moses Zipporah, his daughter.
Which is still a common name in Israel with ladies, Zipporah. It's kind of like a TS at the beginning, Zipporah. Anyway, back in 19, it said that he also drew enough water for us and watered the flock. Remember, that's the same thing, was it Jacob that went up there and he did the same thing, watered the flock for him and, you know, pushed the stone out of the way. And so you're seeing the same parallels again. Anyway, what was it? Verse 22.
And she bare him a son and called his name Gershom.
Okay, Gershom means a stranger there. Sham would be like, hey, over there, Sham. Okay, and then Ger would be a stranger, I believe. It might be a derivative of it. Anyway, so a stranger there. Gershom is a stranger there. Okay. Oh, and it's translated right there. So there, go ahead.
I have been a stranger in a strange land.
That's why he called him that. Okay.
And it came to pass in the process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage, and they cried, and their crying came up unto God by reason of the bondage. And God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob.
Okay, did God ever forget his covenant with them?
No.
This is for our benefit, so that, you know, we have the story coming to us in from our perspective, but God never forgot his covenant. He had a plan timed to the moment. Everything was pre-planned before he created this world. These people are going to go into bondage, and it is going to be a picture of a greater deliverance to come 1,500 years later that we now know. But at the time, he was delivering his people from bondage, okay? This is a picture of that. And how do we know it was timed to the exact minute? Because they left Egypt at an exact certain time. They wandered for a certain time because the Lord took them into the wilderness and they followed the Lord. Okay, so he was directing their steps through the wilderness. He got them to Pi-Hahiroth, which is the mouth of the gorges, with the sea on one side and the Egyptians on the other side. This is all pre-programmed. God already had this planned, and then he sent an east wind that night. If he was there a day earlier or a day later, that east wind wouldn't have been there. But God led this right up into the point of deliverance. Have a great week, Dave.
You too.
All right, see you later. So he didn't forget in the sense that we might be thinking of when we read that. So keep that in mind, that God remembered his covenant. He always knew it, and he remembered it from our perspective. Okay, go ahead. Anybody?
25.
Okay, whatever. Oh, yes, 25, please, anybody.
So So God looked at the Israelites and was concerned about them. Now Moses was tending a flock, the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock into the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God.
Okay, Horeb, all right. Now, people get confused with this, and you're going to hear people say in sermons that there were two mountains that God or that Moses met on, okay, Horeb and Mount Sinai. They're the same mountain. It's a different name for the same mountain. How do we know that? Because he's going to explain here in a few minutes that you're going to come back and worship on this mountain. And then in Deuteronomy, they're back in Horeb. Okay? So keep that in mind that it's the same mountain. This is Mount Horeb. And he led the flock by the desert. Oh, something else I was going to tell you. Oh, Jethro. Reuel, Jethro. And here already they've given a second name. And he is the priest of Midian. Who else was a priest of his family clan in the Bible? Oldest book in the Bible.
Job.
Yes, he performed priestly duties on behalf of his children. He'd sacrifice for them when he thought that maybe they had sinned in their hearts and all that. So this isn't something that was unusual at the time. All right, okay, go ahead.
There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within the bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up.
Okay, you know what? I was watching an account on one of these, once again, returning to like Discovery Channel or something. They say that there is a bush that if you set it on fire, it won't burn because it's got some type of something in it, you know, like lanolin or whatever. And this is a common thing over there, right? It's not, okay? Eventually, the thing is going to burn up. You have a candle, it may look like it's not burning, but the thing is going down. This is a bush that is not burning. It is in the midst of fire, okay? So, you know, and another one, they found manna. Well, it's some stuff that falls off the side of a mountain and you can pick it up and eat it. And that was the manna that 603,550 people, plus their wives and children and everything else, were sustained by this little bit of stuff that flows down the side of one mountain in the middle of absolutely nowhere, right? No, okay? Don't listen to people like that,
amen.
All right? God provided for the people in a supernatural way, and all of these little stupid accounts that people make up to try to justify why their view of the Bible is right when it's totally wrong, don't get sidetracked by that. I remember watching that and thinking, you know, you have to completely dismiss the Bible as it's written to believe these kind of things.
Amen.
Unfortunately, you know, and I get this from time to time, somebody will send me an email and say, well, I saw on the Discovery Channel last night, and then I spend the next 20 minutes typing up this long thing explaining why that's wrong, and then kind of, please don't watch that stuff anymore.
Exactly.
All it's doing is just messing up your heads. Or people will quote, not that there's anything wrong with the movie The Ten Commandments. I love it, and if it wasn't so long, I'd watch it every year. I'd get through like the first hour and go to bed. But people quote the movie The Ten Commandments when it doesn't follow the Bible. It is a story, okay? So, you have to be careful. People quote the Left Behind series. Instead of the Bible, they will quote the Left Behind. Yeah, so you have to be careful to separate stories that are based on the Bible from the Bible itself. Unfortunately, people don't do that. So anyway, go ahead, the burning bush.
So Moses thought, I'll go over and see this strange sight why the bush has not burned up.
Okay, yours says I'll go over. This one says, I will now turn aside, which I just prefer, and the reason why is because that's exactly the terminology that Charlton Heston uses in the Ten Commandments. I'll turn aside. And you know, nobody says that. So it just, I like that. It's just one of those nice, anyway, didn't mean to get off on that, but I really like turn aside. Okay, go ahead.
When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses, and Moses said, here I am.
Okay, so once again, you have the second calling of a name. Abraham, Abraham, Moses, Moses. It's an emphatic and it's also almost an intimate way of addressing somebody. And if you ever want, I've got it on my computer. I never got an email from your daughter with the email address, so I didn't send you anything because I never got anything.
Okay.
Anyway, I have gone through the whole Bible. One of the times I read the Bible, I went through and I highlighted every single time that a double or a triple is used. Moses, Moses, or, you know, the land, the land, the land. I've got them all typed up, hundreds and hundreds of them, all the way through the Bible. And unfortunately, a lot of Bibles that are even consistent within themselves don't do all of them. And so you have to read several translations to find them.